are. It's now Good Friday already. It doesn't seem like 2 minutes since we started the journey on Monday. The journey that was that last week of the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we've gone through the betrayal and him being accused of whatever crime. We couldn't seem to work out what crime he had committed. But we've seen 1 minute crowds shouting and cheering because he's there, and the next minute crowds screaming, "Crucify him, crucify him." And tonight we've come to that bit, and I'm not going to say too much tonight. I'm going to get us all involved tonight because Luke's gospel says it all for us quite clearly. But through the songs that we sing and through the passages from the scripture, there's not too much left for me to say. So we'll make a start with singing a beautiful song. It's called Amazing Love. My Lord, what love is this? And as we've done in the past, please feel free to stand if you want or to sit if you would prefer. Thank you. pick up again from Luke's Gospel. We're reading from Luke chapter 23. And what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to read the very first slide that comes up, and then I'm going to throw it open to anybody who wants to read. Just shout it out, join in. Don't worry if somebody else goes to read the same one, because just as two heads are better than one, two voices are better than one. So if you want to read it, please go ahead and read it. And if you happen to be watching at home tonight, try reading it out loud, because when you read it out loud, it is so much more powerful. So here we go. Reading part one. Jesus is crucified. The soldiers led Jesus away. And as they were going, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, who was coming into the city from the country. Now over to you.
Among them were some women who were weeping and wailing for him. Jesus turned to them and said, "Women of Jerusalem, don't cry for me, but for yourselves and your children."
Jesus said, "Forgive them, Father. They don't know what they are doing."
They divided his clothes among themselves by throwing dice. The people stood there watching while the Jewish leaders made fun of him. "He saved others. Let him save himself. He is the Messiah.
Made fun of him. They came up to him and offered him cheap wine and said, "Save yourself if you are the king of the Jews." Above him were written these words, "This is the king of the Jews."
And he said to Jesus, "Remember me, Jesus, when you come as king." Jesus said to him, "I promise that to you today you will be in paradise with me."
Amen. So we're going to sing again. This is a beautiful little hymn. But from anybody who's here that happens to be a mum tonight, you're going to find this very, very difficult to sing. Okay? Because it actually speaks of the reality of what was happening. For any parent would find this difficult. Any sensible, loving, compassionate human being will find this a difficult one to sing. So let's stand and sing together. While Mary was watching, they hung Jesus high.
His feet hung beyond her, his
second reading, and we'll do the same as the last time. I'll get us started off, and then it's over to you again. The death of Jesus. It was about 12 o'clock when the sun stopped shining and darkness covered the whole country until 3 o'clock, and the curtain hanging in the temple was torn in two. Amen. Another song, very, very old hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. And we have one more reading, so let's read this last one together. The burial of Jesus. There was a man named Joseph from Arimathea in a town in Judea. He was a good and honorable man who was waiting for the coming of the kingdom of God.
Although he was a member of the council, he had not agreed with their decision and action. He went into the presence of Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took the body down, wrapped it in a linen sheet, and placed
Let us pray. Loving Lord, you came into a broken world to usher in God's kingdom. And instead of people embracing your message of love and forgiveness, they chose instead to use a message of violence and hatred. They chose instead to follow a path of evil. They chose instead to look at hardline religious fundamentalism, as we would call it in today's terms, and instead hung you on a cross. And loving God, as we come tonight, we are aware that in that same city today, religious fundamentalism has seen more war, more violence, more hatred, more bloodshed. Even today, will we never learn? At a time when we should be holding hands and crying out to you together for all of mankind, evil still seems to be able to find a way. So we thank you that you came. And we thank you that you came to make a difference. And we thank you that when we don't have the courage, you will take on that power of evil yourself. You have always carried it on your shoulders so that we didn't have to carry it on ours. Lord, as we come tonight, give us a new and fresh understanding and enable us to grow close to you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. I remember many, many, many years ago, there was a toddler that I knew very well. And the wee soul had a streaming cold. You know these horrible ones where your mum's always having to wipe their nose? And he had a high temperature, and he was all aches and pains, and he really just felt generally out of sorts. And his mum said to him, "Oh, darling, this is just so horrible for you. I wish I could have it instead of you." And the wee soul with the wee pink cheeks and bleary eyes looked at it and said, "So do I, Mum." Anybody who has that kind of sense of love can look at that situation and say, "I wish I could do it instead of you." And the God who loves us looks at our broken world and says, "I wish I could carry it instead of you." And that is what the cross was all about. And as the Lord Jesus Christ was saying, "I will pay the price. I will take all of your guilt, all of the things that you have done wrong. Instead of you getting the blame, I love you so much that I'll take it for you. And I'll take your blame on my shoulders. And whatever punishment you deserve, I'll take." And as he's saying that and hanging on the cross, people are sitting at the bottom playing games. And here we are 2,000 years later, and people are still playing games and will do anything rather than engage with the reality of the cross. And it's easy for us to come as Christians, people who have heard a call of God in our lives. We can't blame everybody else because some people just haven't heard that call yet. It doesn't mean to say that they won't. It doesn't mean to say that they won't hear the Lord Jesus Christ calling out to them as well, coming and saying, "I have a better way. Come and join God's kingdom right now. Let me show you a better way, a way of life that will give you peace in your heart, no matter whether life is up or life is down. I've got a better way." And it's easy for us to try and identify with the followers of Jesus who were brokenhearted that night, that were broken at his mum, for goodness sakes, and all those followers who would have been devastated to see this happen and to hear people scoffing, people from the crowd shouting out and scoffing, when the Lord Jesus Christ is saying, I'll carry it for you. And those words, Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing. Even the fella on the cross next to him, you know what? I think if I was that much pain, I would want to save my breath. I certainly wouldn't want it to use it scoffing someone else who was dying the same painful death that I was dying. And the other chap, good on him. Good on him. But here's the thing, and every night this week I've said we've got to ask ourselves a question. We're here because we have heard that call of God on our lives. But if we don't let what happened on the cross make a difference in our lives and transform our attitudes and transform our hearts, then that was a waste of time. And if we are determined in our life to hang on to all of the hurts of the past, all of the bitterness, all of the unforgiveness, and not allow the actions of the cross to move us into a new life, then we are standing amongst the scoffers. That's the reality. If when we are faced with the reality of the cross, we do not allow the power of the cross to transform our hearts, our attitudes, our way of thinking, and our way of life, we're actually standing amongst the scoffers. So we need to ask ourselves the question tonight, where am I standing in that crowd? Whereabouts am I? And am I prepared to allow the Lord Jesus Christ tonight to move me from standing amongst the scoffers or from playing the games to have the reality of the Roman soldier who recognizes that this really is the Son of God? To have the reality of those who are heartbroken, recognizing what this zealous religious attitude has done to the one who God sent? Are we prepared to allow the forces that the Lord Jesus Christ brought into this world of forgiveness and love and compassion and grace and mercy? Are we prepared to allow him to bring those kind of things into our lives and push out the forces of evil? Because that's what the cross was about. The coming together of two kingdoms, God's and the world's. We're going to sing again. And at the end tonight, I'm not going to say a little blessing to say that that's the end. Because this is Good Friday, and we've already read the book, and we know that Sunday's coming. So when we get to the end, we can take a moment to sit if you want. You can slide across and have your cuppy at any point. I'll get Kathleen to play another, just anything at the end. Kathleen, once we've finished this song, if you just continue to play, and folks can choose to sit, you can pray, or you can come and have a cuppy and a chat. But we're going to stand and sing. It's not this song, by the way. This is another beautiful hymn that has those words, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. Let's stand and sing this beautiful song, How Deep the Father's Love for Us.
Beyond all measure, that he should give his only. more.